Hello, Sofa Squad. It's me, Paul, with reporting live from my sofa. How is everyone out there doing? Thank you for joining me, y'all, today here at the squad. We are revisiting Ted Bundy again. Y'all, I didn't think we were going to be talking about him that much more, but Ted Bundy never seems to go away. There is something very fascinating about this case. Now, specifically what we're going to be talking about today is, well, there's a few things. It all relates down to his, you know, ex-girlfriend, whatever you want to call her, girlfriend at the time, his, you know, love interest, Elizabeth Kendall, and her daughter, Molly Kendall. Specifically, we're going to be speaking about the new series on Amazon Prime, and it is called Falling for a Killer. Elizabeth and Molly also did an interview on ABC 2020, and they also released a book at the same time. So this is specifically going to relate to the documentary on Prime. I've been listening to the Audible book, and they all kind of intertwine or whatever. So we're going to be speaking specifically about what we saw in the documentary on Prime. So let's go ahead and get into it. A major thing that I think people were looking for in this is, you know, what was it like to be next to someone like Ted? What was it like to fall in love with someone like him? How could she fall in love with someone like him? Were there signs there that we could say, oh, wow, we could have done that, or things of this nature? Another thing that I think we see going on currently is a situation like Chris Watts, where there's this level of normalcy and, oh my God, you know, that could be me type situation. Well, Ted Bundy was the epitome of normal, and he was out there doing heinous, heinous crimes. I mean, he was a serial killer. And so there is this fascination with it of how could someone that we saw in the public light, you know, this Mr. Polished image, do these things? Well, what this documentary answers, in my opinion, is how that happens. And we're able to see through these interviews with Elizabeth and Molly, his half-brother, Rich, some of the surviving victims' families, friends, law enforcement, all these people, so on and so forth. It paints a picture that we really haven't heard yet. Now, also what we see in this documentary is a lot of footage, camera footage, pictures, things of this nature that we haven't seen yet. The storytelling aspect of this documentary is on point. I mean, if you are into things like I am, like what's the story behind it? How is the story told? You are going to love this. It literally is you don't quit watching it. You just binge all 5 episodes and you're like, oh my God, where's more? So let's talk about some of the specific aspects that stuck out to me in this documentary. Now, one of the things that's interesting, that's like the backdrop of this story, because there's multiple stories and viewpoints going on at one time. That is the story of women's rights. All this was coming up to the forefront, and it's specifically at this campus in Washington where we hear of Elizabeth moving, and this is kind of where she meets Ted, and this life happens. And now remember, she came from Utah, so she's not used to seeing, you know, these, you know, protests and things of this nature. She said this is all very new to her. But also what it's speaking to is the mindset of how women were still viewed during this time. I mean, at one point, someone says, look, we were taught if we were being attacked that the best thing you could do was just to submit to your attacker. And so it's very interesting because obviously that's not, you know, what we hear today. And so here we go with the beginning of, you know, women, you know, getting equal rights and seeking all this stuff and being like, no, you know what, we're gonna fight back. And on the other end of that, we have Ted Bundy, who is viciously, viciously killing women out of an extreme, deeply rooted hatred for them. So that historical narrative woven throughout this is going to be really interesting to other history buffs out there. So like I said, the main focus of this story and kind of the main lens we see this through is through Elizabeth and Molly. So let's go ahead and start with them. And we're going to go ahead and start with the mother, since she is the connection point to Ted that all this began. Now, she says, you know, looking back through all these photos that she was nice enough to share with the documentary, you know, she's just like, look, it's even hard to think now how incompatible the Ted that I knew was with what he did. This was a completely separate person to her. That was very hard for her to come to grips over. And honestly, my opinion is she still is working through that. I think she gets it and she's like, oh my God, like this is horrible. But there is some pull that Ted had on her that you can see throughout this film. Now, obviously, she talks about having a lot of shame to work through, and that's understandable. I mean, that would be a lot of guilt that one would have to work through and a lot of questioning of oneself. Now, she also reads letters that he wrote to her from prison, and in these letters, I mean, he's telling her that, look, y'all are the closest thing to a family I've ever had. You know, she's still emotional over these, you can tell, and it's understandable. I can't imagine what it would be like for the person that you fell in love with, that you're like, this is who I'm going to spend my life with, and it turns out that not only are they a killer and living this double life, but they are to the magnitude of Ted Bundy. I mean, I can't wrap my mind around that. Now, one thing that I think is interesting that I learned from this documentary and hearing her talk is, you know, her talking about when she moved to Seattle. And she moves there, she came from Utah, and she's describing what it was like growing up in Utah around like a very, you know, huge Mormon-based LDS type place. You know, that was the prominent religion there or whatever. And she's talking about the dynamics between like men and women and the expectations and relationships and things of that nature. And so this made me really think, I wonder if her coming from that and seeing that as the norm led to her also having this kind of like, you know, naiveness about a man like Ted when things did start to pop up later in the relationship that was like, huh, you know, even if you take out like, do you think he's a killer? Just, you know, why is your guy treating you like that type situation? Such as when he moves back to Utah and, you know, he kind of just disses her a little bit and these little games that he played with her. She describes the first night that they met at that bar called the Sandpiper and how, you know, he just was this great looking guy. His clothes look like better than anybody else's clothes, and he really just swept her off her feet. I think we can all relate to that feeling, that, you know, that first love, and maybe not a first love for her, she had already, you know, been married at one point, but, you know, just that feeling of, you know, oh my gosh, you take my breath away type situation. And she does say, just like we saw in the movie on Netflix, that, you know, yeah, I wake up and, you know, he's cooked breakfast and there's my daughter and da 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 da, and it was all very interesting. And she said, you know what, yeah, that wasn't something I normally did, but, you know, I did it. We didn't mess around. And it just almost instantly felt right and felt like the family that I was seeking, that last missing component. Now, of course, she begins to reveal some of the more sinister things about Ted. And for example, his stealing. She says ever since she knew him, he was stealing things. And she cites one example of like how he would park his car at a certain place in the mall and go in and get whatever he wanted to and just go out with his stuff. And so that's kind of one of the things I'm talking about where I'm like, huh, you know, that's a pretty big flag there. You know, it is what it is, but, you know, it just makes me wonder if she was around an environment that was like, oh, well, the mail is this and the mail is that, you know, and that's, and also the times and things like that, if that contributed to her to being kind of like, oh, I'm just gonna look past it or whatever. Now, she gets to early 1974. Now, keep in mind, this is when this whole story starts to collide, and she says, you know, yeah, that's when he started acting weird. She says during this time that he would, you know, act really calm in arguments while he would completely rile her up, and to me, that's like a very classic sign of a narcissist right there, you know, the gaslighting and things of this nature. Now, Molly says that she even noticed this change in that, and we're going to talk about her and her dynamic with him in just a minute. She says that she got used to seeing her mother drink all the time, and that really her mom, Elizabeth, was very consumed with the idea that he was seeing someone else. Of course, at that time, she had no idea what his secret was. Now, she says of the day that Ted called her, and basically he was beside himself, and he's like, I'm dropping out of law school. You know, look, I'm going to go to Utah and go to school over there. And she says that he keeps talking like I'm distracted and I'm thinking all day long and I'm fantasizing all this stuff. And looking back after the fact, when she came to the realization of what was going on, she's like, I didn't know then, but he was obsessed with the idea and thoughts of killing people. Some of the other narcissistic things she brings up about him, for example, she says that she was always wanting to get married to him and that he finally agrees to it. They go get the license, but then he basically picks a fight and rips it up. You know, so these are the things where I'm just like, yeah, he had no plans on doing that. You know, that was just him appeasing her, gaslighting her, and pushing it off on her. Remember, he is a master manipulator. And of course, Elizabeth thinks it is her the whole time. She even talks about a time where he missed Molly's baptism. And remember, he's like this, you know, family man. Oh my gosh, y'all are what I want and all this. But these are the weird things that he's doing. He's missing like very important things and whatnot and kind of dipping out when it's like, dude, what's up? And of course, she says, I had no idea at that time. But looking back, it's just like, oh my God, you know, I cannot believe that he was out doing what he was doing while that was going on. And I was thinking, oh, you know, he's cheating or whatever. So on that note, let's go ahead and talk about Molly, the daughter, for a minute. Molly describes a very idyllic view of Ted from the beginning. I mean, remember, she was just a kid. So she's talking about this guy who comes in. He's willing to play with her. You know, he's making her favorite food for breakfast. He's reading her favorite book when he comes over. He taught her to ride a bike. So there's that whole father figure that she never had. Wow, this guy's a hero. And she even said that even at that age, she had this vibe from him that he was like a cut above them. You know, he was able to exude this air of superiority in a sense that made people feel like, you know, oh, this guy's upper crust or whatever. And it's interesting that even she notices as a young child and looked at it almost like, you know, look, you know, marrying up type situation. And so I thought that was interesting that she said that, even all these years later, that she's looking back on that. Molly in this documentary has such an interesting viewpoint. She has such an articulate way. You can tell that she has like spent many, many years, possibly a lifetime, dissecting this relationship. She really summed it up when she said, "He gave you his entire self, which to a child is everything." And that's true. I mean, remember being a kid, that's like what we wanted for our parents to basically just give us their undivided attention. And she said, that's what he was like. He was willing to do all those things without any distraction. He was there for her. Now, of course, just like with the mother, you know, things get weird. The relationship begins to get odd. And, you know, how she spoke of like with the mother situation. Well, she says at one point during their relationship, they were playing hide and go seek. And when she found him, he was under a blanket. And so she pulls the blanket off of him and he was naked. And she was, of course, like shocked or whatever. And he was like, oh no, I'm invisible, but I can't be invisible with my clothes on. So I was trying to hide from you. Like he came up with some kind of thing to play it off. And she says that, you know, even then she knew like, okay, that's weird. That's not right. But she was like, I didn't say anything because I didn't want him to go away. And like, she had this understanding of, you know what, if I say something, it's going to be bad. He's going to have to leave. And whatever, you know, fulfillment he was providing outside of that was obviously greater than that weird feeling. Now, she didn't go into any more details other than that. And, you know, he ran off and it doesn't sound like there was a situation of molestation taking place at that point. But nonetheless, I mean, it's obviously creepy and weird and very telling. Now, she also talks about when he got arrested, you know, how unbelievable it was to her. And of course it would. I mean, she was a young child. And that's one thing that's very interesting is between her and her mother, Elizabeth, is we're hearing the two viewpoints. You know, her mother is coming from like a romantic love, and Molly's coming from a point of view of, you know, like a father figure type thing, like the way we looked at our parents and looking up to them in that context. So it's interesting to see how he was able to really infiltrate both of those relationships simultaneously and hijack them, as I call it. Another interesting thing that Molly says is she says that she always thought about that 12-year-old victim, and when she was younger, and even today, but especially when she was younger, beginning to work through this, once the realization came of what he did, you know, she's like, oh my God, was that, did I do something? You know, was he in turn killing someone else because of me? You know, what did I do? And the mother says this too. And that's some of that like survivor's guilt that I can't imagine working my way through. But especially as a child, to have that burden on your shoulders to think, oh my God, he killed that other girl because for whatever reason a child might tell themselves he didn't kill me. You know, nonetheless, it's still there. That burden is still there. And that must have been a very heavy blanket weighted on her through those years. Now, another interesting thing that happens, and we'll get into this a little bit more, is Molly ends up basically having to, in essence, protect her mother from Ted. She knows the gravity that Ted has with her mother. And so, for example, later before the execution, Ted writes Elizabeth a final letter. Molly intercepts it and burns it and never tells her. You know, because she knew it just takes a little bit for him to get his hooks back in her. Now, there's other people that we hear from in this documentary. Number one, Rich Bundy. Now, Rich Bundy was like his half-brother. And Elizabeth said, you know, yeah, at one point when Ted and I were dating, he would start bringing Rich along on some of our camping trips and things of this nature. And Rich, there's a big age difference between the two. And Rich describes Bundy in that same type way. Like, you know what? This was like more than a brother. This was like, you know, a father figure. This was someone I aspired to be. And he says the same type things that Molly did, you know, even once he was charged with the initial crimes of the kidnapping and all that type stuff. It was something where it was like, well, this is a wrongly convicted guy. And when he escaped, it was, well, you know, yeah, you know, you've wrongly convicted him. So it's interesting to see that. Now, once it came to light, and we'll see this with other people too, of, oh my God, like the evidence is overwhelming. We've made it past that first trial. And yet this guy has provingly done some horrible things. That's when the enormity of it set in. And this trauma sets in too, because you're like, oh my God, you know, this person who I have looked up to like a parent, you know, like a big brother, a best friend, has turned out to be, you know, a psychotic killer of great magnitude. Now, one thing that's interesting with Rich is he lives in a camper, and I can't tell if it's like out of in a trailer park or outside of somebody's house. And I'm not trying to knock him living in a camper. God knows, if you follow me, you know I do camper life too right now. But it's interesting because he speaks of this trauma, and it makes me wonder, you know, has this affected him to that point? Is he not completely capable of functioning? He kind of seems like he lives off the grid a little bit, and that's cool, but I just wonder if his experience with his older brother had a hand in forming that. Another powerful aspect of this film is hearing from the victims, victims' families, victims' friends, police, lawyers, people of this nature. So let's talk about a few real quickly. So we hear from the first victim, Karen Epley. Now, she survived. Back in 1974, Ted broke into her place. He used a bed frame to brutally attack her. And I mean, she had like permanent brain damage from this. The injuries were so significant and so brutal. Now, remember at the same time, what we're seeing during this documentary is Elizabeth talking about, oh yeah, well, at this time in 1974, so you're seeing this difference of, here's this person's experience with Ted, which leads to more than likely death, but there's a few very lucky ones that didn't. And then you're hearing Elizabeth, who's like, well, no, we're having this normal, you know, life together. Yeah, things are getting weird, but I don't know that he's out here doing this stuff. Now, Karen laid in her bed for like 18 to 20 hours until a roommate found her. Thank God. I mean, it's a miracle that she lived. And now she said she hasn't spoken out or really done anything with this case because she didn't want to be a victim all her life and kind of known as that, if that makes sense. But also because it was just another thing of, no, I don't want to be identified with Bundy. We also hear about the victim, Linda Healy. We hear from her housemates. Now, they show us pictures of this house. We hear the story of the evening. And this is common in all these that they're doing with these different victims and people they're talking to, is we're hearing it from their perspective. What's scary is when they realize how much time Ted must have spent in the room. You know, because this is the young lady who her bed was made up and all this type of stuff, and it looks like he dressed her and then left the place with her. And that's the creepy thing about Ted Bundy. You know, if you were to ask me if there is a real person who that is the closest representation of Michael Myers from Halloween, I would say it's Ted Bundy, because he has this ability to just appear and disappear and make people do the same. An interesting thing that we heard about from Linda's family and friends is them saying, you know, not only does he rob them of this human in their life and what was to come of her life, but also of the past memories, because now even when they think of the happy times with her, that's still marred in like a little bit of sadness. Janice Ott was one of the victims at the lake, and they actually talked to a guy, his former DEA person, who was at the lake hanging out that day, and he saw Ted Bundy talking to her right in front of him. And he's describing it, and he's like, yeah, you know what? She had just gotten there, she was sitting down, and essentially she was being nice and, you know, kind of like, look, I just want to relax, I'm not really looking to help someone. And she kind of got up like, oh, I can't believe I'm doing this. And of course, after the fact, it was, oh my gosh, you know, when people started to realize, wait a second, two people have gone missing at the lake this day. And now remember, after the fact, they also learn from this day, the guy's name is Ted, this is what he was driving, you know, he had the cast on his arm. They kind of get the MO. This was the beginning of the end for his crime spree. Another survivor they speak to, Carol, she was actually at a mall. He approaches her pretending to be a cop, and he's essentially like, look, your car is being broken into, you know, could you come with me? And she's talking about this, and she's going, and again, these people are describing what it's like to interact. And especially back then, where, you know, you did things for strangers. It wasn't like now where somebody comes up to you, you're kind of like, what do you want? You know, it was a lot different back then. And also, Ted manipulated and exploited the kindness of women. You know, women are always going to typically be more of the nurturers, the carers. Oh, you're injured, let me help. That type person, more empathetic. And he knew this and exploited this. So Ted kind of walks her through everything. He gets her in the car. He's going to take her to the police station. And she said, once they were on the way, immediately she realized, oh my God, I've made a mistake. And she said, he essentially pulls up on a curb. And she described how he became a completely different person. You know, and many people will talk about this, and we'll get into that a little bit later, as to how something comes over him and this other entity, a very evil force, becomes him. And so luckily she was able to fight him off, get out of the car. He chased her a little bit, but she got into the road and somebody picked her up. Now she would be an extreme downfall for him because she would end up testifying later in court against him. So let's go back and talk now more about Elizabeth during this time of the trials and kind of like Ted's downfall. So now as all this stuff starts to come out and the police know they're looking for a Ted and all these type things, you know, this doesn't look good. And Elizabeth's kind of like, huh. Well, then the composite comes out and literally all the people in the documentary they talk to are like, yeah, that was him. That was him. Now they show a picture of Ted and that, and I'm kind of like, but I guess if you knew Ted in person and then you saw this, it was very similar. So Elizabeth says she saw that and was like, wait a second. Is that my man? And so she was just like, oh my God, this isn't good. So she calls the police. Now she wrestled with this. If you follow this case, you know this. This is like, oh my God, you know, should I do this? Should I not? So she calls the police. And essentially, they check it out, and they're just like, nope, nope, done. We had him on the list, but it's all good. So now think about it. If you were wrestling with that, and you were like, well, wait a minute. I mean, I'm in love with this guy, and he's this way, and the police said no. Yeah, I mean, I can understand how you would be like, okay. But she seems to have been ignoring that gut feeling that just kept coming back. So during this time also, you know, Ted realizes, like, okay, my gig's up here. I got to move on down the road. So he's like, I'm going to Utah for law school. Now, I think it's interesting that he picks Utah because I think that he did that to also be like, I know she's not going to go back there. And he's kind of like, you know, well, I'm going to give you the chance to go, but she decides not to. And it's this weird thing of almost like, okay, well, I'm gone, bye. I mean, to me, it was just weird the way it was done. But again, I think it was a narcissistic manipulation on his part. So during this time, more girls, as we know, they start missing. And Elizabeth's saying, like, yeah, well, that's what my friend's like, girl, I'm not trying to be like a party pooper here, but I'm just letting you know that your man moved to Utah, and now girls are going missing there too. So just putting that on the table for you to check out. And again, she wrestles with this, and then she ends up, you know, calling the cops there too. And it's the same kind of runaround with them. And she even says, like, I gave pictures of Ted to them, and, you know, they said that they showed him to a victim, and the victim was like, no, that wasn't him. But you got this vibe, the way she was telling it, that the cops basically didn't believe her. And again, she's talking about, like, you know, this whole thing of like, oh, this is just some worked up female, da 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 da. So she's like, you know, I called my dad and was like, look, you're a male, will you please contact them? And even her father was basically like, girl, find your chill. You know, if this is wrong, this is his career. And no, we're not going to do this. And so you still see, again, with this whole backdrop of, you know, women's rights movement, things like that, how it's the male is being protected here. You know, oh, well, if his career is jeopardized and all that, mind you, you know, he's out there butchering women. So that was interesting. But also Elizabeth says, you know, if Molly had called me with this type of information and for whatever reason, I told her, oh, you're being over, you know, reactive, dramatic, whatever. She's like, I would at least call the next day and be like, okay, hold on now. What'd you say again, girl? You know, run this by me one more time. And she's like, but nothing. My father never mentioned it again. Now, eventually, Ted is pulled over and he has all that sketchy stuff on him. You know, the crowbar, the mask, the this, the that, all this, you know, his kill kit. His Walmart kill kit before there was a Walmart kill kit. This is when the case really starts to pop off. Now, during this time also is when Elizabeth talks to a female cop. And she begins to talk to her and the female cop listens to her more. And she's like, like, okay. Now, also, you got to remember, Ted's been arrested for this kidnapping gig, and it's kind of like, okay, you have all the sketchy stuff, da-da-da-da-da. We have someone sitting here saying, look, I'm his girlfriend, and I'm telling you blank. So that dynamic is very interesting. Now, Ted gets out on bail, and they're kind of like back together. And again, she's like, I'm wrestling with these feelings because here I've turned him in, essentially. You know, but this dude is, you know, going up against trial. Now, of course, when he gets found guilty, she thinks that he's been wrongly persecuted. She goes into kind of a downward spiral and starts drinking again. So let's fast forward to what was going on during his escape and the second escape where he's able to get out and be gone for a while and start killing people. Now remember, very soon into his stint, it starts getting charged with these other killings in Colorado specifically. They ship him there, and honestly, it's kind of like the situation of, it shocks me when I see, like, interviews and stuff, how freely he moves about. You know, I'm kind of like, well, no wonder the guy escaped. And people in this documentary are saying, look, we told them, y'all, this is not good. He needs to be in maximum security, so on and so forth. So there's that. Now, remember, the first time he escapes, he, like, jumps out the damn window. I mean, he's just like, bye, see ya. And so he does that. He's not gone too long on that one. But the second time, he finds a way. I mean, he loses weight. He finds his way out of that little light hole in the prison jail. And he gets out, and he's gone. Now, to me, Ted is in a fury at this point. He finds his way through hook or crook, through flight and train and all this stuff, down to FSU. And these brutal, animalistic murders take place there. And Elizabeth says in this, when she saw this on the news, she was like, I was sick. I was like, oh my God, it's Ted. Now we hear from detectives in this too, who are like, well, it wasn't the MO. You know, I mean, he likes to kidnap someone in the car and go do this. And so he's like, I might have been slightly, you know, dismissive about it. And I'm like, yeah, slightly, I'm sure is a key word here. But nonetheless, eventually he is captured. And during this time, he calls Elizabeth. And basically, he had told the people who caught him, I'm going to tell you who I am after I can make a phone call. Because remember, things were different by then. They didn't have all the stuff we have. I mean, he was basically like, you know, no man's land to them. They didn't know who they had, which is just hard to wrap my mind around. But he knows it's not good. He knows his gig is up. Once they discover who he is, it's going to be done with. The killings that he did at FSU were so brutal and heinous, and the beatings too, because people did survive that. I mean, he had to have known, I'm going down for these two. So, that being said, he contacts Elizabeth, and he tells her that he's in Florida, and she says, my heart sunk, because everything was just like, oh my God, it was Ted. You know, everything added up then. And basically, she's trying to ask him, like, you know, did you do this? But he's being evasive because they're on the phone and people are listening. He does eventually say that he is sick and that there's something that he can't be around. And she understood that to be young women, that he was talking about his obsession with killing them. Now, again, at this part, she's asking, did I play a part in this? Were you essentially killing them? And I think for us on the outside, looking back, we can kind of see a large part of it was that first girl that came into his life. But of course, she didn't know this at this point. And even then, so it doesn't matter, because you would be thinking things like, well, gosh, did we get an argument that day and he went out and killed somebody? I mean, there's so many different layers to this. Now, he told her that she didn't play a part in that and that he had been fighting off the sickness long before they met. Now, she thought he was going to confess to her, but he didn't. He, like, drug it out for a few weeks. She says when he did contact her again in a few weeks, whatever spell she was under by him was gone, and she just really didn't have a desire to talk to him. Now, she says it wasn't until this confession and realization that she began to rebuild her life. She quit drinking, she went to therapy, and things of this nature. Now, the subject of his last girlfriend when he was incarcerated, Carol, is brought up, and Elizabeth is like, you know what, when I started seeing that whole, you know, circus going on, I was like, you know what, thank God it's not me. She's going to get roped in just like I was, and he's going to use her up and throw her away. Now, we don't hear from Carol because she died in 2018, but we do hear from some coworkers and colleagues and people like that. And they said, you know what? Yes, she was really big on the anti-death penalty thing, and she worked with causes for that. And she had this idea that she was going to get Ted Bundy and kind of save him. Now, it was brought up that Carol had a brother who died under her care. He drowned when, like, she was babysitting or something like that. And that they felt like, you know what, this played a big role because she wasn't able to save her brother. She really wanted to save Ted. Now, of course, we know Carol would go on to marry Ted. He would propose to her while she was on the stand in the trial for the murder of the 12-year-old, which is just repulsive. Then she would end up having a baby with him. So that's a whole other thing right there. Now, a friend of hers said that Ted became very obsessive, very demanding, jeopardized so much of her time because, remember, he was just using her. He was using her as a pawn. He needed someone else. He had run out of options, and she began to grow tired of this. Now, fast forward into this, once she realized, and it came to the truth of, yes, I killed these people, this was rather devastating for her, because she stood by his side, and I mean, against all odds, was like, no, he's being railroaded. This is how everything is spewed differently, and da-da-da-da-da. The way she found that out is because as it got closer to his execution date, he basically was like, look, should I do, you know, confess to where these bodies are to get more time? And they call it like bones for time, where if you're going to be like, look, I'll tell you where the bodies are if you give me more time before you put me to death. And that's when it hit her, and she was like, oh my God, like, I have been completely snowed. Now, the day of the executions, they go over this, they talk to some of the victims and stuff like that, and family members, and, like, some of them are like, yeah, you know, burn them. And other ones are like, we don't believe in the death penalty personally. You know, we don't believe in another mother having a child lost. And even one of them said, look, I talked to Ted Bundy's mother that day on the phone, and we were just two mothers who had lost children talking on the phone. I don't blame her for that or anything like that. And I thought that was really interesting. Now, another interesting tidbit throughout this documentary, let's kind of round this out here, is how many people talk about how much Ted Bundy was so normal. But then few people who saw this were like, you know what? He flipped at one point, and I saw this dark entity just come over him. Like, his whole aura changed, and it was just weird. And now, one of the people in this, one of the law enforcement agents said, when he got around Ted and he was like this, he described it as frustration and doom. And he said, I knew from then on out, when I got that energy around a perpetrator, whatever, that I was in the presence of someone who had murdered in cold blood, not like self-defense or whatever. But until he met Ted, he had never felt that. And this was a very common theme that people described. Now, a huge question was, you know, have you ever felt in danger with Ted? And the only thing that Elizabeth really said was one day they were on a lake and it was very cold, they were rafting, and he kind of violently threw her off of her raft. And she said, I was in the water and looked at him, and it was like he was another person, like he had gone somewhere. You know, and she was like, I wasn't scared, I was pissed that he did that. And she was like, eventually he kind of came around too, and he was like, well, don't be such a, you know, wussy or whatever. And she said, but looking back now, she was like, I think I glimpsed that evil Ted that some people never live to tell of and that other people talk of. So to round this out, definitely, if you are into true crime, watch this. If you're into Ted Bundy, watch this. It is definitely interesting. My 2-cent take on it is this. I can completely see how she fell in love with Ted. I can completely see how this is a nuclear family in a sense. Yeah, the aspects of like when weird things started happening of, is he cheating? Is he doing this? Started coming up. You know, that could be explained away of, oh, maybe I'm insecure. Maybe I'm this. Maybe I'm that. So, you know, a lot of, nobody was there in her shoes to live through this. And that's kind of why she's like, you know what? I'm going to put this story out here. You know, they did the movie on Netflix and she ended up helping with that. But she was like, that's really condensed, and I wanted to tell my story, because when we see these levels of manipulation like this by these evil people like Ted, we're not there to experience how it just encroaches in on someone in their life. And so I think that she really did a good job at explaining that. Like, look, this was a family man. I mean, these are our family photos. And Molly even says that, look in these photos, I'm playing with him. I completely trusted this man. There was nothing about him that said serial killer. And that is the fascination with this case, is how eerily normal, but how hauntingly evil Ted Bundy and his crimes were. So that's it. I hope you enjoyed this. Definitely check it out. We might even do the book for a book club. If you want to do that, let me know. Drop it in the comments. And also, let me know what you thought about the documentary. Did you like it? Did you want more? I'm curious to hear from you. So thank you very much. Don't forget to check out our podcast. Links in the description. And I'll talk to you soon. Bye.